Ladies and gentlemen, colleague architects, colleague students, dear friends, tonight we have a pleasure of hosting an extraordinary architect from an extraordinary office. Mr. Friedrich Ludwig has agreed to come. He represents the London-based office named ACME. I don't want to spoil the file, I don't want to say too much. I think his work, what they do, it will speak for themselves, for itself. So I would just let you enjoy the lecture, and I hope this is just the beginning of your journey with ACME. Ladies and gentlemen, give a big round of applause for Mr. Friedrich Ludwig.
Speak too much about the office, but I shall try to say a few things about us. We are called ACME, and ACME stands for quite a few different things. We don't do ANVIS only, but ACME kind of is an old American name, among other things, standing for a company making everything. And I think we were quite keen to not get shoeboxed into the first thing that we do. So I'll show you the first thing that we've done, but we've tried to do other things afterwards. And we've tried to stick to that name of a company making everything. It does mean other things too. It also means doing the best possible in Greek, which we thought was quite nice. If you've watched American cartoons, it is also the source of an endless supply of things that the coyote never manages to catch the roadrunner with. ACME is a place that is headquartered in London, but we do try to work in quite a few places. So we now have 4 offices. Berlin is opening in a couple of months. San Francisco and Sydney are from last year. And we've grown over the last 7 years to about 60 people now. And being in London is quite nice because it's quite easy to be international. So I think in the moment we have about 21 nationalities, which is what you see in the different strands of color over the last 7 years. On that slide, we've worked in quite a number of different scales, and we've worked in quite a few different countries. And so that's the last kind of 7 years of kind of global spread. And what I wanted to talk about a little bit today was a question that we've asked ourselves, and that I've asked myself even before we started ACME, is how do you actually work in quite a few different places and in quite a few different scales? And how much do you need a signature? How much do you have to repeat yourself every time? And what's our actual relationship with the place? And you might have seen that building before. I'm not sure if it looks pretty good. Mies van der Rohe, quite nice, nearly square, 8 columns, floating roof. It was designed as a headquarter for Bacardi in Havana in Cuba. Didn't quite work out. Is now sitting happily in Berlin as a National Gallery. Exactly the same, but as you see, the furniture has slightly changed from a Rama headquarter to a National Gallery. And I think while maybe international style is a little bit out, I think it stands for us for a very interesting question as to how much does it matter what you do, and how much does it matter kind of where you do it, and is it actually fine to just take one thing and put it somewhere totally different? And is it the same if you do an office headquarter for an alcohol company or a National Gallery? And I think in that sense, I think for us, we found it a bit more exciting to actually say we bring with us a certain amount of interest or fascination to each place. But I think each site has its own interest. And I think in as much as, you know, a Labrador and a poodle produce a Labradoodle, which is quite fashionable in England at the moment as a new breed, I think we see that a little bit as our relationship to our sites is very much having an affair, maybe, or having a relationship, a temporary relationship maybe, with a place that produces something unique, which is its own Labradoodle, no matter where we go, no matter what project we do. We have a lot more tools than we had before, but we don't think that actually the tools really change anything, because I think kind of there's more we can multiply, or there's more we can kind of manipulate. But I think the basic questions and the basic materials of architecture haven't really changed, and I think it's actually quite interesting to not try to use always the newest materials, but actually to do something which is about place, which is quite local, and which we find is an incredibly good excuse to not repeat ourselves. Because actually, if we go into every location and we bring with us our baggage, we tend to not have new ideas every week, probably not even every year. But each place is incredibly different. And so in as much as kind of we might try to repeat ourselves, if we are open enough to our context, actually what will come out every time is actually quite different. And so in that sense, I think I would like to talk about 6 projects, each of which has a certain amount of repetition on a number of different scales, from very small to very big, and I hope quite a bit of difference. I've never tried to talk with a break, so I'll try to get to the middle, and then I'll break. If it gets too long to get to the middle, then you have to let me know. The very first project we've done is a very small house. It's sitting in a very wet part of England, and it's not just raining, it's also just incredibly wet ground, and it's very close to sea level, and it's basically slightly underneath sea level in quite a few areas, about 1 to 2 meters down, so it's a bit like Holland. And you see our site is this little postcard picture of a windmill. And what these windmills do is they pump water. They pump water from the field to make sure that you can actually do something on the field, because otherwise the field would be underwater. It's incredibly picturesque. And that is the view that most people know of the project, because on every weekend you can rent a white big boat, and you don't need a boat license because it's a very slow moving boat, and you can ship down up and down this river. And so there's quite a lot of people, slightly drunk, who just kind of pass by the house on this river. And the house has been there for about 150 years, the mill itself is 400 years old, and as you see on the plans, it has had a bit of cancer. It's had a few outgrowths and a few mutations at the back especially, so it started off as a very simple box, and then they realized it didn't have a kitchen and it didn't have a bathroom, so it had a little bit of a mutation to the left and then a mutation to the right, and then 4 more mutations to the back. So what the client said to us, this is the original view, and that's the picture postcards over time. And you see it doesn't necessarily get better when you see it from the back. The client said, I would like 1 more bedroom, please. And we looked at it from the windmill, which is the right photo, and we just kind of felt maybe 1 more bedroom is 1 too many. But it was clearly not right. I mean, there was, you couldn't get from the bathroom. The bathroom was on the ground floor. The kitchen didn't have a view of the mill. Nothing actually had a view of the mill. So we thought, okay, it needs a bit of a sink. The second problem he had is he had flooded twice in the last 4 years. And that wasn't going to get any less in the next 50 years or so. So what we saw is maybe, and what you see in the front here on the right side is a flood defense. So the river is actually a meter higher than the field, and there's a flood defense here that prevents the garden and everything else from flooding. It just so happens that the forest floods, the forest on the right, and then it just comes through the back. So the first thing we did is to just ask the government whether we could build a new flood defense around the house. So that's the house with the old flood defense, and what we've done is we've just talked to the farmer next door, and we've managed to buy a little bit more land and try to create something which you can defend. And so that was the beginning of a new house. And then we've asked the client whether he would mind if maybe we would actually reconsider this cancerous outgrowth of the last 100 years, and maybe if we could demolish a little bit. And as you see here, kind of, it wasn't evil, but it was incredibly contorted. So what we proposed was whether he would terribly mind if we would remove all the things drawn in red. So basically, return it back to what it was. And maybe then to actually do something which is a little bit more hidden than what you've seen before, to actually do something which is a bit more like a camouflaged object, where you don't actually see that we've done anything, where it is a bit more hidden behind the landscape or the context. And we've tested a lot of options of how to do that. How do you actually deal with something which is so original, and how do you extend an original? Do you extend the back? Do you extend to one side? Do you extend to all sides? You're just surrounded with other things. And we thought maybe it's actually interesting to work with repetition, to work with the original thing that was there, and to try to find a way of not competing with it, but extending that language into something that makes sense on that side. And the final project that came out of that, if you're looking from the right angle, and that angle is very much when you're coming around the river and you're getting to the house, you can't actually see anything. It is basically as it was in 1848. There's a millkeeper's house for a millkeeper. that's meant to be pumping water into the river. And as you sit there in your boat, you suddenly realize that somehow the house has acquired a shadow. And the shadow happens to have exactly the same proportions as the house. And then maybe you have drunk a little bit too much, as there's another shadow, and eventually there are three shadows on one side, and then there's four shadows on the other side. And so what we've tried to do is to do something which is subservient to the original, which doesn't try to say kind of it always looked like that, but which actually has a relationship with what's there, and has a very different relationship with the landscape. To do something which is, we feel kind of adding spaces and adding experiences to the house that the old house doesn't have, but in such a way that the old house doesn't lose its character. So the old house is what you see here, as a very simple rectangle. The last part is exactly the same footprint, and there's three parts in between, which kind of in between, and try to kind of avoid the new flood defense, which is running around the back here. What's above it is a very simple house with as many bedrooms as a normal English client needs, and you shall never underestimate how many bedrooms an English client needs. And then a way of building a roof which tries to keep the language of the gables of the old house, but in such a way that it actually looks roughly the same on both sides, but obviously one side is much shorter than the other side. And that's where the slight weird triangulation comes from, and that's why it actually has four houses from one side, but three houses from the other side. A view from the helicopter, and a view from the inside, which is very much driven by our desire to create something which is actually open to the landscape on one side, but kind of also framing outside spaces, and working within the rules of England, which can be incredibly strict if you're building on land which is in the floodplain, in a nature reserve, in the biggest bird wildlife reserve in England, which means you shouldn't be here. So the rules are such that you shouldn't really build more than 10% of what you had before in increase. So it's a very small house. It's 200 square meters. And to make it a bit bigger, it has voids. And the three voids is what you see here. There's a smaller void over the kitchen, and then a larger void that tries to work with the old heights of the house, but actually make it feel like a much taller space than it actually is. A couple of views across, and a view of the old, the last part of the ground floor of the old house. The other thing we've done is to try to work with materiality, and what you see is a corridor of the first floor where we've tried to make something which feels quite monolithic. We don't have much space and we don't have much height, so we can't afford a fake roof. So everything you see is the actual structure of the house. The wall is the structure and the insulation. So everything is made from solid timber, and all the doors are exactly the same width as everything else. So if you close a door, it actually is a kind of 200 millimeter object of timber, which is incredibly nice acoustically, but also gives a certain sense of kind of solidity to the house. View from inside across the landscape. In terms of materiality, I think we've tried to take the same approach that we've done to the overall shape of the house, is to try to work with, in a way, repetition of what is normal. What you see on the left, special buildings in Norfolk are meant from flintstone. Flintstone is what you get on the Baltic coast, the kind of black-capped stone, the lava one. It's a very beautiful material, very difficult to use, so if in Norfolk you want to do an important building, you do it in flintstone. If you're a rich farmer, or maybe a slightly poorer farmer, you build your house in brick. And if you really don't care, you do it in black timber. So all the farm buildings, all the boat houses, everything that's kind of not important is black timber. And so what we saw, that's actually a quite nice material to build a shadow out of. And we've tried to teach the English people how to char and how to burn timber, and we didn't manage to get that to work because they don't take it very seriously. So when you ask a builder in England kind of whether you could get charred cedar or charred Siberian larch, they give you a very superficial char, which after a couple of days of English rain comes off again. So we had to go to Japan to get yagizuki. Japanese are much more serious about burning timber. So the char is a really deep char that doesn't go away, and it's incredibly safe because the insects hate it, because basically there's nothing exciting left in the timber. It's just coal. And that's what makes the exterior of the house. So it's from the inside, it is solid timber. From the outside, it's clad in burnt timber. And that's a quite simple way of building in the countryside, because weight is quite important if you sit in the mud and if you're very close to the water table. So that's a simple way of building a house in 5 days. So it's just craned together from solid pieces of timber that interlock, where you can actually insert all the power cables and everything else, as you would in a kind of Swiss timber house. Apart from that, we've tried to be standalone, as we are about 4 miles away from the next village. So we are getting our own water out of the ground, we're filtering it, we're running it through cooling pipes in the mud to create heating and cooling, and we try to do as much of our own heating and electricity as we can. So the building is pretty simple in its own ways, but it can actually stand alone for quite a significant amount of time. So that's where we started. That was the in-between. Then 5 days of building, and then quite a lot longer of cladding. A second house, and I think this isn't necessarily the only scale we work in, but it's an incredibly nice scale to experiment in a very pure form. So it's a useful way to explain kind of how one reacts very differently in a slightly different part of England. We were approached by a client. He's got a site in Kent. Kent is where the rich people live who don't want to live in London. So it's a beautiful part of countryside, about 50 minutes out by car. And he owns a large garden surrounded by fields and apple trees. That's his house, and that's the stables for the non-existing horses. And what he asked us to do is whether we could build a new house for him, and then he could sell the old house and retire happily. And what we thought about is, how do you build on a site which doesn't have a context? It's incredibly different to Hunstead Mill. Hunstead Mill had the most important context known to Norfolk. We were on all the postcards. Everyone comes by on the river. Everybody really cares. This is the exact opposite. This is a piece of grass in the countryside surrounded by trees. There's no postcard. There's no relationship to any historic. There's never been a building. And how do you kind of create a context out of nothing? And the first thing we said, maybe we just don't build a building. We just lift up the grass, and we just kind of say this was always countryside. So our relationship to countryside is to try to keep it countryside as much as possible. Didn't quite get this very far. His client said, I don't want to live underground. Was quite nice though. So the next thing we did was take a drive and drive through the rest of Kent and try to understand Kent a bit better. And what we've learned is that Kent has a new language that we didn't speak, because every one of these dots is a certain type of building. And a certain type of building looks like that in section and is what every house in Kent seems to have, which is a place to dry your hop. So everybody seems to be into making beer, or at least was. And so there seems to be a whole language, an architectural language, that consists of houses with circles. And you think it's a joke, and then you keep driving a bit further, and all the houses do actually look like that. And you kind of think, it's an interesting language that maybe I should try to learn. And so we've tried to kind of catalog what we found. And so we've built ourselves a little alphabet of all the things that seem to be part of this language. And there are quite a few different letters in this alphabet. And they get used for all kinds of things these days. And so we've tried to speak the language. This was our first words. That took about 4 weeks of us trying to say something that feels like it's kind of using the language of Kent and actually says something for our client. And I think what we found is that it's an incredibly inward-looking language. The buildings have very little relationship with the landscape. They're very much kind of centered on themselves. So what we've tried to do is to find a way of breaking that open a little bit without leaving the language, and try to find a way of building a house that is very much a 21st century house, but does feel like it belongs to Kent, and you wouldn't have done it anywhere else in the world but in Kent, because it's very much part of a vernacular that otherwise you would think is the most crazy thing you'd ever thought of. The one thing they also do is they work only in brick. So we thought we can do that. We can find a way of tiling a house in brick that actually learns to deal with these different geometries. We can also work with colors. We can maybe have something that blends from a very dark tone to a very light tone as it goes up. And so that's a view of the house and a night view. It's a very simple set of spaces, and I think what we found interesting is that in the way of repeating the same element 5 times, but never quite kind of separating them, you actually create a quite interesting internal space that kind of meanders. So you don't just have a room and a door, because the language doesn't actually have corridors. The language just seems to create pockets. And these pockets are actually a new way of thinking about space, because it's not about saying, I've gone from the kitchen and living room, I'm just a bit more in the living room area, a bit more in the kitchen area, but it doesn't actually have this one and two binary relationship between spaces. So that's a very simple ground floor, a very simple first floor, and an incredibly interesting section, because the height of those houses is incredibly high. So you have a ground floor, you have a first floor, and you have about 8-9 meters above that, which these are the planning drawings, so obviously we haven't shown anything. But obviously, as soon as we actually would get the house built, you would start putting in mezzanines. And we thought it's actually quite exciting that each of the children could actually afterwards inhabit each of these spaces on their own, because you could decide as a 7-year-old or as a 10-year-old what kind of spaces you want to create for yourself in the future in this amazing volume of 10 meters above you. A cut through the middle, and then a simple set of elevations. In England, normally, you try to work with your planning officer, and you only go for planning if you actually have support from your council. In this case, the council said, we are absolutely unrelated to Kent and terribly ugly, and they would recommend us for refusal. And in this instance, you would normally give up, and our client just said, well, I'm just going to try. And he talked to a couple of other local neighbors, and we went to the committee, and the committee voted 11-0 in favor of giving us planning. Which I think is interesting, that even though, you know, we shouldn't be here and we're building in the open countryside, people felt that it was actually an interesting and relevant addition to Kent, and even though the planning officer said it shouldn't have planning, they just gave it planning anyway. In terms of materialities, what is interesting is if you do know how to script in Rhino and Grasshopper, you can do something quite traditional in a way which maybe isn't built in the most traditional way on a material scale. So we've worked very hard to actually find ways of scripting the facade of each of the buildings in such a way that we can talk to a contractor in very simple means as to how to build this, but it is actually one continuous brick skin. And these are some examples of another building we're doing in the moment for Leeds, where we're kind of sees a similar approach of actually taking that language from a kind of digital grasshopper realm into reality. And a very brief view across some of the inside spaces, which maybe explain a bit better this notion of kind of not having rooms with doors, but just basically having a meandering space with pockets. The third one, slightly related to the second, and related to the question of repetition. A site in Hamburg, opposite the main station, so on the most important street in Hamburg, Mönckebergstraße, the street with the highest amount of footfall, the old gate into Hamburg, heavily bombed, and right next, the site sits here, right next to the most important 1920s area of brick expressionism in Germany, which is a phase of incredibly innovative brickwork, based on Höger and Schumacher and a couple of other German architects who were quite young at the time, and who managed to take the language of kind of Art Nouveau in a not kind of French way, but in a kind of German, more expressionist kind of hard way, but incredibly playful with brick and with terracotta and in the way it plays with three-dimensionality of surface. The designs for our site from the time, from Pölzig and others, and our current occupant on the site, which is a concrete box from 1965. You see on the right side, on the left side, the original, on the right side, how it looks in the moment. The reason one has to touch it is the terracotta is falling off. So it's a typical German 1960s facade. They were built with 40-year life expectancy, and they are now generally 52, 53 years old, and they do actually fall off. And the reason they fall off is they crack at that point here and at that point here. And so what you see there is a mesh. It looks like a pigeon mesh, but it's not a pigeon mesh. It actually prevents people from getting killed. And so the question is kind of, what do you do if the whole building behind is actually a functioning building that you're not allowed to touch, and you just get a job to just touch the outside? and the inner skin is totally blind. There's a couple of windows, which you see partially here in yellow, but basically all of those are storage spaces, so the building itself doesn't want any windows, and the client's very clear, he wants no windows. And what we saw is there's a discussion to be had about the flatness of this job. Somehow, you know, if one gets that as a job, just sort out the orange, it doesn't feel like a very deep question. And we started to think about how much deeper could we make that question, and this is one of the nicest kind of late 1920s buildings of brick expressionism, which are very much about speaking about tectonics, but also speaking about a plane and interest in dimensionality of surface. And if you are next to the most important brick buildings in Hamburg and the most important brick buildings in North Germany, isn't there something better we can do to that facade, which doesn't just mean re-cladding it with a flat skin? And you see the innovation that went into 1920s brickwork, and I kind of felt, as one of the few people in the office, that it would be nice to continue that discussion, which people had 100 years ago, which seems to have died a little bit, which is actually about playing with the tectonic and sculptural potential of a very simple piece, repeated. Because none of these pieces in most of the brick facades are specials. They're all totally standard brickwork. It's just about how you repeat them. So what we started to think about is whether it would be possible to build an incredibly light wall, because we are basically taking down a wall of an existing building, and whatever we're putting back has to be exactly as light or lighter than what we're putting on. And what I've learned in Norfolk is that the best way and the lightest way and the most cost-efficient way to build a wall is to build what the English call a crinkle-crankle wall, which is a self-stiffening brick wall. There's no way you can build a single-skin brick wall unless you curve it in plan, because otherwise you need wind posts, as in a storm it would fall over. And this wall has less bricks than any other way of building a brick wall of the same height in the countryside, which is why farmers would use it in the countryside who really don't really care about design. And there's more contemporary ways of doing that, which is the same about how to build with the minimum of bricks the maximum of wall. So what we've tried to do is to take a bay of the facade. So this is our facade, 25 meters tall. And to test if it would be a single brick wall, how much would it stand up? And what you see in color is in all the places where it doesn't stay blue, where it goes red, it would basically collapse because the wind load on a facade that's retained every 5 meters is too high. If you start to deform this facade into something that's slightly curved, both in plan and in section, you see that with a little bit of increase, this is just 20 centimeter deformation, suddenly the facade is behaving a lot better than a flat wall. And as you keep increasing it to 60, suddenly the wall goes stiff enough to stand on its own as a single brick wall. You have to keep doing that both in plan and section. You can't just extrude it in one. And this is some of the tests that sit behind that, that we've done with Knippers Helbig, the engineers from Stuttgart, to try to get the optimum performance out of a simple brick wall with the minimum amount of restraints and the maximum amount of expression. And the final result is that we are able to kind of work with brick with the maximum rotation and shift between itself that you see on this page, because obviously each brick can't be too far away from the next brick. You can't make the wall too curved, otherwise you lose contact between pieces. And so there's the minimum rules that you have to apply to the game. But if that's the original facade, which was 24 centimeters deep, we are replacing it with a 60 centimeter deep self-stabilizing brick wall that weighs slightly less than this terracotta facade that we're demolishing and doesn't need any further structure. So that's three typical bays using the same brick about 400,000 times. So it's a full-on repetition. There's not a single brick in there which is special. With a very simple set of restraints, back to the columns, simple section, and an elevation view from afar. And I think what was interesting for us in that is it doesn't say Chilehaus, it doesn't say 1920s kind of Hamburg brickwork, but we feel it finds a way of taking the same experimentation that Höger or Schumacher used in Hamburg about 90 years ago, but it uses technology that we have today to actually do something which is a little bit more intelligent than maybe what they could calculate in those days, where we feel also for the first time it actually anchors this building in Hamburg, where we wouldn't have done this building anywhere else. It is the way we've designed it because it sits next to the Chile House, and that's what actually made us do things on this instance here that we wouldn't have done anywhere else. Okay, I'll stop here. Is that roughly half an hour? Okay.
Zapraszam wszystkich na przerwę. Wracamy za 15 minut.
Before I move on to more kind of larger architectural buildings, I wanted to show you one other one, which to us is very much related to that one, in that it's just a surface. And it's a very different surface, but it has the same thickness and in some ways the same constraints. It's a project we've worked on for quite some time before the civil war broke out in Syria, in the outskirts of Damascus. And we've worked in a couple of different buildings. This is the last one that we've worked on, and it's the only one where we didn't do the whole building. We actually just did a very small part of a very large building. So what you see here is the building. The building is a shopping mall by a client from Dubai with a designer from Seattle. And it looks incredibly American. And we didn't want to have anything to do with it. And somebody said, would we be prepared to look at the central space of the project, just the roof of the central court? And what they had was an American courtyard type central space. And their philosophy seemed to be that what the Syrians have been waiting for the last 100,000 years or maybe 50 years, is for an American shopping mall. And I think we felt that maybe the Syrians do actually know a lot about shopping, and maybe they don't need the Americans to teach them how to do shopping, as Damascus is either the oldest or the second oldest city in the world, continuously inhabited for 6,000 years. And what you see on this diagram is a part of the old town, highlighting, among other things, a couple of 500-year-old shopping malls. There's the Straight Street, which is here. There's the other part of the main souk, Umayyad Mosque, and some of the kind of more regional shopping malls. And when you walk around Damascus, it's got an incredibly fine grain of retail, which has its own architectural typology. You see here kind of a zoom of how those spaces are working. So that's a courtyard and that is individual shops. And there's a language in plan, and there's a language in the roof section. And that, for example, is a caravanserai that was used for retail for about 400 years, it's from 1660. So to us, it felt quite odd to say that the Syrians don't know anything about shopping, as we felt they know more about shopping than most of us. If you go on top of any of the existing buildings in Damascus, that's the view that you have. It's an incredibly flat city. Everything is about 3 to 4 stories. And what you see is a very interesting roofscape that consists of two parts. The first one is domes, and that's some of the domes from the inside. And the second part is linear roofs. And so this is the Straight Street and Souk Hamada. And you see this one, these ones here are about 400 years old. These ones here about 1820s, 1830s, 1840s. And what they frame is, you see them kind of snaking through the city. So there's amazing structures that are changing the nature of a street across the whole length of sometimes 500 or a kilometer. They're a little bit rusty, and they have a very special light, which is incredibly magical because you just get these tiny pools of daylight that comes through and sunshine that comes through and hits the street. And what we felt is actually if you were to try to ask us to do a roof for a retail project in Damascus, what we should do is have a good look at what actual old roofs in Damascus looked like and see whether we can't find a more contemporary interpretation of that without making it an American shopping mall. There's two types. There's domes and there's arches. And what we've tested is just to test both of these spaces, a simple vault and a kind of domed vault, and just test them across the space that we have, which is about 140 meters by 60 meters. So it's about a bit smaller than a football field, but quite large. That's some of our initial tests. And what we've tested was, how do you span maybe without any columns? So this is using a very simple section that runs across. And if you just work with the material that they have, which is concrete, kind of how could you do something that's maybe is quite heavy and actually uses what the local skills they have to create a roof over a space that otherwise doesn't have much identity. We've tried quite a few different versions. And what they came back to us with, which we found quite interesting, is that actually they said, we don't know steel very well. We don't have any. We would need to import it, and importing things into Syria isn't easy. That was before the Civil War, but it wasn't easy. And so any of these structures, you know, if they rely on tension cables or anything else that holds them up, the Syrians wouldn't really know how to do. What they said is, we've got lots of Syrians. Hand labor is incredibly cheap, and a Syrian laborer costs less in Syria than a Bangladeshi laborer in Dubai. And if you've seen Bangladeshi laborers in Dubai, they don't get paid very well. So, well, we thought that's interesting. If actually what they know is concrete, and what they're good at is carpentry, and what they have a lot of is people who can work and who are keen to work, what we should do is try to work with concrete in the same way as they did in 1600, to actually just use concrete only under compression. Never have it under tension, don't have any reinforcement, do pure compression arches. So what we try to work with is to actually go back to the old ideas of how to build a cathedral, and how do you optimize a structure in such a way that what happens is each arch stabilizes the next one. So what you see here is a stress diagram. And what you see is that if you curve a surface like that, if you curve paper like that, it becomes quite stiff. If you keep doing that, it becomes an incredibly stiff surface that can span up to 100 meters. If you change the frequency of how the arch goes, if they're sometimes higher and sometimes wider, you can balance out the different forces that each arch is putting into the next one. And if you allow the columns to have a flare, they become incredibly efficient because they actually stop having tension at those moments, because that becomes a compression member. So if you spend enough time simulating this in a computer, you can actually optimize each of these curves against each of the other curves until each of the curves is holding themselves in equilibrium. And so you have an arch that has no reinforcement, and that actually is 6 to 7 centimeters of concrete, and the only thing that's complicated is how to build it as a formwork. And that is the one thing that you would never get away with in Europe, at least not in England, because you would need a lot of hand labor. And that's the one thing, they have thousands of workers. So they were happy to build the scaffolding, and they were happy to build the formwork, as long as there wasn't any steel in it. The next thing we then said is how to build openings. And the Syrians know a lot about openings and how to create an opening in a roof surface. This is Zukamada. And that's a simple way of how to make an opening in a concrete wall or in a concrete roof. So what we've done is we've just used the old typology of a bathhouse, that's the hammam. So the hammam basically just has bottles cast in upside down that just actually create a light that comes inside. And so that's the outside, that's the inside of the same space. And you can scale it up and you can scale it down for a quite large 140 meter high structure. And what you get out of that is you get a structure which has no direct sunshine, but has a lot of light that moves through at certain times of the day in very specific patterns. And so what happens is that the roof actually becomes alive, because light falls through the roof at very different times of the day and makes very different patterns on the floor that you see here, kind of from morning over lunchtime to kind of afternoon to evening. So you've got an incredibly lively space because these patches keep moving around. And so a very simple system of working in a kind of Syrian way of penetrating a surface and creating openings can create an incredibly simple system to form a roof that to us feels incredibly Syrian, but I think kind of is very different from what they would have done in the 18th century, but still very related to where they are. And so that's the final structure and the final view from inside. What we've done, apart from openings, is we've mirrored the rest of the ceiling with small mirror discs, which is something that you will find in many of the mosques in Damascus, that the sky above the graves of the daughters of the Prophet generally have small mirrors embedded in the ceiling because they're basically creating a star sky above the grave, so that the person who's died, when they look up, they see into the sky. And so that's, we found a quite interesting way of actually working with light in the evening, because otherwise the roof was dead. So just by embedding small mirrors, you can actually look like you're during the day and during the night and have a different kind of lighting performance that still feels quite familiar between the two. The next project I want to briefly talk about is a little bit bigger, but tries to address the same question in a number of ways as to how do you work with identity, local identity, and how do you work with something that's very simple and of its place. Doha is the capital of Qatar. Doha is quite young for our, let's say, Polish, English, German understanding of age. Doha was a village in 1950 with about 3,000 inhabitants. It now has 1.7 million. And what you see here is the coastline of Doha over 50 years, 60 years. And as you see, they have actually changed quite a lot on a more or less national or regional scale. So that was the coast as it was 60 years ago, and that's where the coast is now. And you see the scale of Doha at the time. It's a village, there's a marketplace, and there's one mosque. 10 years later, that's when they found oil and gas. That was 10 years after they had found oil and gas. And you see that's all sand landfill between those two. And that's 3 years ago. When you go to Doha today, when you go to Qatar, this is very much what they think of as their front door, the place where if they want to show you how Doha looks like, they will take you here. So there is a bit of Arabic Sea, and there's a curve, and there's a couple of towers. And that's the moment is the front door, or the capital, and kind of the representative space of the country. The corniche is used, especially in winter and in autumn and spring, when the temperatures are a bit lower, and at night. And I think it's fair to say it isn't evil. It is okay. It has some qualities. It is used by some people, not by many. The question we were asked, we were one of three who were asked, was by His Highness the Emir, whether we could recreate the identity of the country across 11 kilometers, which we thought was a quite interesting question. It's maybe the same question that we ask ourselves on a smaller scale quite often. And so what we felt was that maybe 11 kilometers is a quite long question. And maybe the answer shouldn't necessarily be 11 kilometers long. Maybe the answer needs to have a couple of more chapters. And maybe those chapters shouldn't be totally different, but there should be something that's happening, because 11 kilometers is basically 3 hours of walking. And in Qatar, nobody walks, because they just drive. But you can't drive the corniche, as there's no road, so it probably needs a little bit more ideas than just kind of saying, let's create an 11-kilometer project. If you look at what's behind, Doha has quite different areas. This is diplomatic, this is business, this is tennis. That's the Central Park, this is the government, this is the old town, and that's the museums and the new museum by John Novell. And so if you look at it, it is not one city. It is quite different parts of a city. And we felt that probably also the corniche shouldn't have its own identity. Maybe it's enough if the corniche just takes the identity of Doha and just projects it and intensifies it, so that that becomes an even more diplomatic area, and maybe that becomes an even more sporty area, and this becomes an even more cultural area. So we've tried to find a way of somehow making breaking an 11-kilometer question into maybe 1 or 2 kilometer answers, but on the other hand also to kind of relate to what was there. That's the old coastline as it was in 1960. And I think what we felt is that in 1960, Doha was by the sea. If you look at those images, you know, you feel like there is a very immediate relationship between houses and water. And somehow over the last 50 years, they have landfilled and they have landfilled and they had landfilled. So what you have now is that was how it was. There was a city and a sea. They've put so much more stuff that we felt putting any more stuff is not the right answer. Ideally, actually, we would like to bring Doha back to the water rather than increasing the distance between Doha and the water anymore. So what we've done is we have basically said we don't want to reclaim anymore. We are reclaiming 4% more. But we want to build quite a lot of structures, and these structures are related to what's behind. And we want to redefine the edge between land and sea in such a way that actually it isn't one answer, it's many different answers. So that sometimes the answer becomes a beach, sometimes the answer becomes a hard edge with water, sometimes it becomes steps. So that there's a more complex answer rather than just giving one answer, there's many variations of that answer. If you currently go and go to be received by His Highness, the Emir of Qatar, this is where he would receive you. This is the Emiri Diwan, the guest room of the Emiri Diwan. So if you're a president, if you are anyone, you will come here, and that's where you have an audience with the Emir. His father's Diwan looked like that. So you see, there's been some change recently. But the same principle still applies. This was the space where the family, the ruling family, would receive visitors from other families and from other countries. If you go back a little bit further, that was the actual original Diwan. That's the traditional space where in Qatar you would receive a visitor. And you can see how over 500 years that evolved, and then somehow they've tried to make it into architecture. But actually, it's a language that comes from being a nomad and moving through the desert and finding a way of living with change, because actually, architecture in Qatar was always about doing something for 6 months and then moving on, doing something for 6 months and moving on. So architecture for the last 500 years in Qatar was not in stone, it wasn't in concrete. Architecture was a fabric that you would hang onto the walls of your space. And those fabrics would be knitted by your wife, woven by your wife, and they would speak about her family and your family. And that is in color, in pattern, in the way it's put together. And a Qatari wife would, apart from producing children, spend all her life working on the walls of this room. And that's what, you know, carries the identity of the country and the family. And so we felt maybe that's what we should try to do. We should try to make the Corniche like the Diwan of Qatar, in the same way as you would take a visitor to that space. If a visitor comes to visit you, we should maybe be able to scale that up to the scale of a country. So if that's the entirety of Doha, one could actually work in the same way as a wife of the family would be working with pattern and color to create surfaces that speak about tradition and that speak about the future. You could work with the patterns and color of the 11 families of Doha, and there is only 11 big families. You could work with a language of architecture that is not too far away from what they've originally done, and you could, rather than importing new vegetation, you could actually work with the trees that are normal in Qatar, which are not palm trees. The actual trees of Qatar are quite sturdy but quite beautiful desert trees. So what we said is, we would like to plan quite a lot. 60% of space actually should become Qatari landscape. And all the bits that we wouldn't be planting, we would actually work with Qatari patterns in a way that would be recognizable to a Qatari family. We would work with very simple stones, very simple elements, repeated a number of times in the same way as a normal Portuguese paving is using repetition of very simple elements, but the way you put them speaks about whether it's your family or somebody else's family. And the same way as the Copacabana or Benidorm, you know, create identity out of pattern. One can work with the traditional Qatari patterns that you will find in the Emir Diwan and in any traditional Qatari house in a way that's relative to kind of where they're coming from. And all these photos are from three houses in Qatar that, you know, are some of the better preserved ones of kind of what the traditional language of pattern is like. So what we did is we identified each zone with one pattern, and each pattern we identified as one shape. So some of them are octagons, some of them are pentagons, some of them are triangles. We've identified each of them with a specific palette of colors, which are relating to one of the traditional families. And we tried to take the very simple kind of 1920s, 1930s type architecture. It looks like 1920s to me, it isn't, it is older than that, but the original language of Qatari architecture into something that we feel is close enough to where they come from, but kind of slightly far enough to not be fake. And that's some of the architecture that is currently there. To try to work in a scheme that afterwards has no maintenance, so that if you do everything from Qatar, if you use trees from Qatar, if you use grasses from Qatar, they should be able to survive without watering them every night. And if you actually look at how much water you need for a tree, and if you think that our project is 11 kilometers, if we keep planting relatively large trees, each of which needs 200 liters of water a day, in a country which has absolutely no sweet water, then we're talking about 17 million liters of water a day. And that's where we felt it is important to actually take a slightly more grown-up approach to what you can do and what you should do and what's actually sustainable, because every liter of water has to be desalinated. And for every bit of desalination, we need to burn gas to run the power plant which runs desalination. So you should be very careful and you should be as intelligent as you can with the green that you're planting, because it makes a massive difference to the lot of water we're spending on this. So that's the trees that are native, that actually we quite liked, and we think one can teach the Qataris again to kind of like them. Because they're quite large, but they're incredibly good at holding water and they're quite good at creating shade. The other thing is there are quite beautiful flowers which are native. So we're basically trying to do 80% of all planting with purely Qatari plants, 20% is for plants that are regional but not from Qatar. And trying to push the foliage so high that you can still see the sea, because in the moment the sea is basically disappeared from your life. If you live in Doha, you hardly ever see the sea unless you really go to find it. To then try to combine that with a simple architecture and quite a lot of structure. So we have to build new roads, we have to create shadow walks that you can walk in shadow, of which we need 11 kilometers. We need a sun walk and an evening walk, which is what you do when the sun sets down. We need quite a lot of bicycle stations, because if you want to teach Qataris to cycle, you have to give them a bicycle station every 100 meters so that they can change their mind, otherwise they wouldn't do it. You need a camel pass, because the only thing they actually enjoy riding is horses and camel. And you need a people mover, because they might want to go somewhere, and we might teach them to walk, but there needs to be a way for them to come back to their car. And you couldn't ask them to walk back. So you need a people mover who picks them up when they decided that walking is gone too far now. A water taxi for the ones who actually want to not move in the people mover, because it's maybe not exclusive enough. An e-buggy for the ones which are too fat to fit in the people mover. We will need to feed them, because they wouldn't be able to walk for longer than a kilometer without the promise of good food. And we need to have kiosks, because they might forget to buy water, and then they need to buy water immediately. Because they really haven't walked in a long time. They have gone so used to driving, and they are the second most overweight country in the world, that it isn't an easy task to just suddenly tell people to use the spaces outside without air conditioning anymore. We need to teach them to play outside again, and maybe actually also enjoy the beach, which in the moment they don't, but the diplomats might, which is why the beach houses are only in the diplomatic area. And to have prayer rooms, because Qatar has the highest density of mosques in the world, per capita and per square meter. So if you create a new project, at least every kilometer you need to have a new prayer room. It is not possible to see toilets, because that's not clean. So we had to invent a new typology of underground toilets that we can hide behind the seawalls. And an awful lot of functions in sport, water fountains and bird towers, wildlife and events, and a way to actually display art, because Sheikha Mayasa and Sheikha Mosa have been the biggest buyers of contemporary art and traditional art for the last 4 years worldwide, and are buying about 400 million euros worth of art every year, and nobody can find it. And so we thought it would be quite nice if there's a way for them to actually exhibit some of the art that they're buying, not just in the museum, the EMP one and the John Novell one, but also outside. And then lastly, to actually work with water, and to work with water not just on a small urban scale, but to try to think of water as a national scale, or let's say a kind of regional scale. So what we developed is WET, who are amazing water feature consultants. I said I would like to have a water feature that could actually swim in the sea. I would like a water feature that can actually work with salt water, not with sweet water. And I would like a water feature that actually could react to the events in the city. So it could sometimes be in the cultural zone, sometimes in the diplomatic quarter, sometimes next to the park. So what we've developed is a water feature that can sink itself. It's floating in the sea, and it's made from 40 elements, each of which are like a boat. And each part of these things floats in the sea, just under the surface. If you need a water feature, it comes up. It is up to 140 meters tall, which means that even on a citywide scale, you would actually see it. And when you're done with your water feature, it just disappears again under the water. Each of the 40 boats has its own diesel generator, so each of the 40 boats can be radio controlled from the city, but actually can do its own thing. And so the pattern you see here is kind of one of the millions of things you could do once you have 40 water feature boats that are floating through the city. We would need to do lighting, and we saw that's actually an interesting way of celebrating a shape on an urban scale, because lighting on its own is a design question, but over 11 kilometers it becomes a quite large sculptural question. And there's things you can do with that which actually speak about the whole space that otherwise, as a pedestrian, you would never see. So that's a brief walk. That's John Novell, which is under construction at the moment. And so that's the beginning of the new Corniche in the art area. The first of the sculpture park, with EMP in the background. The first part of the amphitheaters, of which there are three, as one approaches the souk. Then the restaurant area next to the historic souk. The area of the park that's next to the Doha Grand Park, which takes the language of the park to the sea. The large parade ground that they've asked for military parades. And that's what we had to show them to ensure that they're happy with the amount of military we can put on the parade ground. The first of the beaches before you get to the diplomatic quarter. And you see in the way the pattern is changing, there is a consistency in the way the pattern is applied in scale, but there is a difference in each of the zones. So if one goes back and you just look at the ground, there's a specific color and there's a specific pattern for each part. But we hope there's enough consistency in the way it's applied that it feels like one corniche, but it changes as you walk through it, so it doesn't have the same identity everywhere. Getting closer to West Bay, the more business area of the park, the Pearl Museum, the new hammam that sits on the beach, and then the last part, the diplomatic area and the beaches. What's interesting in Doha is that they don't have a lot of imagination. And so we thought we had done quite a lot already, to explain our proposal, and they said that wasn't very clear whether we could be more specific. And so they said, we would like a model, please. And we said, well, if you want a model of this project, we would recommend a small segment. And we said, maybe we could do a little bit of beach, a little bit of heart, one or two restaurants, maybe a bit of hammam, maybe like the table. And they kind of said, no, we would like to see the whole thing. And so we said, well, what scale were you thinking? Because, I mean, it's 11 kilometers long. So maybe if we could do 1 to 1,000, that would be 11 meters, which we think is quite large. And I said, we're not convinced. 11 kilometers is probably what it is, but 1 to 1,000 is very small, no? So we went around and we looked at lots of marketing suites. We looked at Canary Wharf in London. We looked at King's Cross. We looked at the Olympic marketing suite for London Olympics, which is a quite big project. And London Olympics, for example, was 1 to 300. King's Cross was 1 to 300. Canary Wharf was 1 to 300. So we said 1 to 300 is a good scale for a very large project. And I kind of said, so how big is a person? And I said, well, you know, 8 millimeters. And they said, no, we want 1 to 100. And we said, well, it's 11 kilometers long. So as you probably have figured out, 1 to 100 at 11 kilometers, 110 meters. And that's probably a bit expensive. And Qatar is per capita the richest country in the world. So they just don't care. So they rented the largest exhibition hall you can rent in the Middle East, which is 150 by 300 meters. And they called some Chinese. And we actually built the whole thing in 1 to 100. Which is interesting because you haven't actually designed anything like that in 1 to 100. So it's totally out of proportion to the amount of resolution we had because we haven't drawn, I mean, you don't draw a project for a competition at 1 to 100, not 11 kilometers. But it's interesting to walk through, as has a lot of detail. There's a toilet there, playground, bicycle track, people mover station, Jeff Koons, more playground, amphitheater, restaurants with people. See, all the people are actually wearing abayas and traditional Qatari dress, so it's a proper model. And sadly, it wasn't enough, which is interesting, that actually we presented to the emir, we presented to his wife, we presented to the crown prince and to Sheikh Mayasa, and they still haven't made a decision because it probably wasn't clear enough what the offer was. So if you go to Doha, you'll find a tent. It's standing next to his palace, and it's just waiting. I wanted to finish with two projects, which are two very different answers to a very related question. Both projects are office projects. They are very similar in size. One is in England, one's in Germany. And what you see is difference, not just difference in place, but also difference of attitude of the client, a difference of kind of relationship to context. The first one is in England, and in England, if you design an office building, you never know who's inside. So you can only design an outside, but it will always be let after the architect is finished. But the context is very rich. So Minories is a scheme in the center of London. This is the city. This is the Tower of London, Tower Bridge, London Bridge, Stock Exchange, and Swiss Re is here. Here, the Gherkin. It's an incredibly rich part of London. It's the old Roman London, so it's about 2,000 years old. And it's just before the Old Gate. And our site is everything here. And in the old days, this was called Butcher's Row because there was a tax to take live animals into the city of London. And the city of London started here. So just before the city of London was a row of butcher's shops, and the butcher's shops had slaughterhouses at the back. So the sheep and the cows and the pigs would come from Essex and Sussex and wherever, and they would be led down here through a street called Blood Alley into a pen, into the slaughterhouse, and they would come out at the front a sausage and then go into the city. So for the last 500 years, our site was where all animals for London got butchered. There was a certain murder case, and Jack the Ripper was probably living at number 62 Aldgate High Street, which is this one. As Jack the Ripper was very good at cutting up women, and he was so good at it that it was agreed at the time that he probably must be a butcher, because he wouldn't normally be that good at cutting up somebody. And there was a certain person who was sent to a mental asylum, and nobody was ever murdered afterwards, so it probably was him. And so we thought, how do you design an office building in the location of the living and workplace of Jack the Ripper in Butcher's Row? The site today looks very different. The site today is part of the usual planning background of London. You've got underground lines passing through. So this is our site here. And as you see, that's the circle line. That's the Aldgate East line. We've got a bus station on the site and a couple of existing buildings. So what we've thought about is kind of how do you, in that context where you can't do much inside, how do you actually kind of work with identity? If it can't be about the inside, because the inside is just an office building. So the size we have can be this one. We can't be taller, because there's a sideline from the tower. We can't be wider, because there's a bus station and other things underneath. The first thing you notice is that we are on the tracks. And being on the tracks means that we have to have very few legs. And in the moment, we're allowed to have two legs at the front. And those two legs have to be dug extremely carefully into a wall that sits between the tracks of the Metropolitan line and the Circle line. So these two legs will hold up about half the building. So we thought there is an interesting language maybe to kind of create from that. And if you're at the front, you have to do quite weird things. Maybe you can carry that through to the rest of the building. And so if that's the front of the building with the circle line passing through, and if that's one leg and there's another leg there, maybe one can actually find a way of using those two points, this one here and this one here, which are the only points where we're allowed to come down, to actually build a real arch. To build a real arch, which actually expresses the fact that we are balancing on two legs over the tracks. And that's something above that, which then kind of can be a quite normal building. That's the amount of transfer structure we need at that point to get over the tracks that run through here. And the same section with the tracks running both ways through the building on the other side. And so what you see there isn't fake, that's actual concrete. And that's the actual minimum concrete we need to hold up the building. And it just so happens to be colored in a certain color, because it happens to be exactly where Blood Alley is. And we haven't told the client, and we won't tell any of the agents. But it was our way of kind of, because you can't really say that would you like an office space, you know, that seemed on Jack the Ripper. You have to find a way, I think, of kind of preserving some of the identity of that site in such a way that it isn't offensive, but that actually there is something that is remaining behind as a richness of that tradition that actually, if people are interested, they might find it. So that's what was in the past Blood Alley, which afterwards will be the office space of the office building on the ground floor, and then a simple floor above. What we thought to do above is to do a building which has two faces, in the same way as certain criminals might sometimes be quite normal people during the day. So what we've tried to do is to work with a very simple system of vertical fins and just buy a little bit too many and buy half of them slightly inclined. And so this is some of the first tests we've done for that. And most of the work that has gone into this is to optimize solar shading. So they do actually have a function, and they are optimized to create the maximum amount of solar shading on the east and west facades, depending on autumn and summer sunshine. But what's interesting is that actually, if you color them in different ways, you can actually create a building that looks quite different as you move around it. Because if you color a fin red and green from one side and blue and yellow from the other side, as you move, suddenly the building becomes incredibly dynamic. And so this is some of the tests we've done to see kind of how far we can push that in the next stage. And the final unfolded one in the moment that you see the pattern that emerges from a very simple repetition of very simple elements intersecting. There's a couple of other buildings sitting behind. The only other one I want to talk about is a secret residential building that we smuggled in at the back that the planners didn't notice for a while. There was a little plot left over, and we thought it would be nice to find a better use for it. So we've tried to design a residential building that sits in the shadow of the other hotel we're building. So this is the office building, that's the hotel we're building, and that's the residential building, which just sits in the lowest part of the site. And we thought, as a facade idea, we have to do a lot of things for daylighting reasons and for privacy reasons. The shape of the building is determined by the setbacks we have to have from our neighbors. So there is a neighbor here that we need to set back on the lower level, and we need to lean back here for sunlight to the courtyard on that level. So what we thought is would be quite nice, without telling anybody, is that actually we would design a facade based on a butcher's glove. And if you've seen a proper butcher, they have incredibly beautiful chain link fence metal gloves that protect your fingers as you work with whatever you're working. And we thought in the same way as the front of the building is talking in its own way about what Aldgate High Street and Butcher's Row was about, it would be nice to deal with the lack of privacy and the daylight constraints in such a way that actually it relates to where we are. And that's why I felt there's an interesting building to be created which actually takes a butcher's glove and turns it into an architecture device that mediates between privacy and public life and allows you as a resident in that building to actually control how much other people can see of you. And that's two of the views of the back with the residential building as it's leaning against the background. The last one is the reverse of Minuis. The Federal Bank of Saxony is a competition we've won last year for a very interesting client. And what I mean by the reverse is that in England, you never know for whom you're designing. The Federal Bank in Leipzig, we know exactly for whom we're designing because the person who will be the owner and operator of the building is the one who's actually building the building. And so where in England, you always work from the outside in, and you can never get in very far. This for us was a competition that is totally about inside out. The site in Leipzig is a typical socialist site. There's socialist 1960s housing, an old hotel from 1910, a couple of post-reunification buildings. The context is so confused that the planners said we can do whatever we want. They said if you feel like another tower, you could do a tower. If you feel like a long block that closes the edge, you could do a long block that closes the edge. And you see the streets are quite diverse in their identities. So from a very open socialist kind of 1960s understanding of urbanism to a slightly more kind of 1920s or kind of 1800 definition of kind of Leipzig as a rich city of the past century. And what's interesting about the bank, the Federal Bank, is that they have no customers. Nobody ever goes to a Federal Bank. You can't give them any money, you can't have a savings account, you can't get a credit card. They're just giving money to the state. So there's different departments, and each of the departments is in charge of distributing money into Saxony. So there's one department giving money to farmers, one to space research, one to urban research. And so that was a bit of a weird brief to work with. The second weird part was it's a site that's in the center of Leipzig, in the old garden area. So it was out of town, just next to the old city. And it was covered by Baroque gardens. Incredibly beautiful Baroque gardens. Anybody who was anywhere in Leipzig, you would have a good Baroque garden. And you would create different follies in your garden, follies for play and for entertaining and for relaxing. Most of that's gone, so the city afterwards became an incredibly dense urban city and is now kind of a very mercantile place of trade. We've tested a lot of different ideas as to how do you work on the site, from an urban question and from an inside question, how do you want to work together as an organization? And what the bank said was, we don't want any people to come to us, but we want to make a present to the city of Leipzig. We want to give the city of Leipzig a special building because they haven't had a special building in the last 20 years. And we feel that we are rich enough to do that. This was the very first test. There was a couple of more tests. There was never-ending degrees of tests of the definition of a mass. And I think when you, this is Google Images. If you type bank into Google Images, you get that. But you found, I didn't type in bank temple or bank anything else, I just said bank. There's a very clear idea of how a bank looks like. And that seems to be consistent. The top left is Australia. This is the States. This is the Bank of England. This is the German one. That's another Scottish one. There seems to be a very clear idea as to why a bank needs to look like this, and we think it's about looking stable. I think we want probably our money to stay where it is. We want to give our money to somebody who doesn't gamble it away. And somehow a temple seems to say stability and safety, which is what we're all looking for in a bank. What the bank said is we don't really need an identity as we have no customers. We kind of thought maybe we can be a little bit more playful with how a bank looks like. And maybe one can just have columns like a bank has, but maybe we can just have too many columns. Maybe in a normal bank you seem to get, you know, 5 to 10, and then you get a building. But there is a space in between the actual building and the outside space, which seems to be about columns. Maybe we could actually just have a lot of columns. Maybe we could have so many columns that you might never find the bank, because the bank doesn't actually want to be found, because the bank doesn't want customers, because it's a federal bank. But it actually still speaks about stability. It's incredibly stable. It's pure stability without any work. And then we thought maybe we should be trying to work with that in a slightly more playful way, where actually when you see it from the street, it might say bank in a very kind of simple column-free way, but it does might invite you in. It might not just kind of say stay out. It might invite you in, but it's not about finding the bank. You might find other things between the columns. Maybe there's a clearing or a park. So maybe the bank gets pushed to the back of the site, and we create a quite large space in front. Maybe we even create penetrations in that bank. But maybe it's a little bit more like Alice in Wonderland. So you actually never quite find the bank, but you find all kinds of surprises, which are actually quite nice. And don't necessarily involve the bank managing them. They might actually just be an architecture. And maybe that's about the space. Maybe that's about the light. Maybe it's about the openings between the columns. And maybe also you could kill sometimes larger patches of columns and other things could emerge, which actually speak more about Baroque gardens. Maybe in the same way as a Baroque garden in Leipzig on the site would have had different follies and different identities, you could find different patches within the forest that speak about different parts of landscape. So that's the initial site plan of a roof and some of the tests that went behind that roof. And then a ground floor plan to go with that, so that the bank is actually the least important thing about the site. There is a bank here, and there's a bit of a bank here with a canteen and maybe a conference center. But actually everything that really defines the space in the center of the space is three openings. One central opening here, and then two smaller openings, one here and here, within the forest of columns. So that's the basic form of massing as it builds up, cut in such a way that the building never becomes a wall, but the building always allows for reviews through, both on the ground floor but also on the upper parts, so you don't have this background of a kind of closed object. And then something that has enough opacity in front of it that actually you can have a hint of a building, but mostly you have a promise of space. some of the spaces in between. So that's some of the openings on the ground floor and some of the openings at the top, a simple set of elevations. And then maybe there could be some hidden things in there, and maybe it could be Jeff Koons's dog, maybe some other things that you would find that you wouldn't have seen from the outside. And what you see here also is, in order to kind of try to disguise the building as much as possible, the facade of the building is not straight. The facade actually creates different spaces that come out to avoid to break down the scale of the building as much as we can, so that the actual elevation of the building becomes more like that. A view from some of the upper floors of the offices back into the central space. And that's one of the typical gaps between parts of the building that kind of breaks the building, rather than being a long L, into four different distinct parts. A simple setup. And we've tried to group all the spaces in the office building in such a way that you don't necessarily have any cellular offices towards the forum. If you want your own office, you have to sit outside. If you want to have the view of the forum, you're not allowed to have any walls. So that actually, even as you move through the building, if you're working in the building, you're open to that space as much as possible, and anyone who needs more privacy just goes onto the more private side to the context. The bank was a bit nervous about what they were getting themselves into. So the bank said, how does our space compare to other public spaces in the world? And we said, well, it's smaller than Trafalgar Square. In yellow, you see our space, in red, Trafalgar Square. It's a bit smaller than the central space of Leipzig, which isn't small. But we said, I think there's a very big difference between the space that we are building for you and the central space of Leipzig, because the central space of Leipzig is empty. There's nothing on it. And if there is nothing on a space, if space is hard and it's not occupied, on a Wednesday morning at 10, it will feel incredibly empty. But what we said is that actually it's a very different space, because the space is not 100 meters wide, it's not 60 meters wide. Between the columns is sometimes 2 meters, sometimes 3 meters, at a maximum 25 meters. And that's the actual space that you will be receiving. And the surface isn't just one simple set flat surface, it's actually a quite complex surface, because we can build a lot of difference into that ground, we can build a lot of activity into that ground, so it doesn't have to become one simple empty space if it isn't used. Because the bank said, we are not an event organizer, and we're not a organization space for public concerts and architectural lecture series. So I think our response to that is to say, in architecture, you can create so much complexity that actually the space will find different users over time that don't necessarily need management and that don't need somebody full-time employed. So that's a view across some of the denser spaces, some of the very open spaces. And I think a big part of that is the function of the columns and how much the columns actually can create space. And there are things we can do with the columns that isn't just pure architectural. We can actually use them to do part of the cooling of the building and some of the shading of the building. So in the moment, we're going through a process of optimization where it isn't just about creating a public space, it's also about making the columns perform for the building as much as they can, so that it can be as low energy as possible. With a view of the clearings, so that's the current size of the clearings. And then a solid roof above. We have tried to kind of explain how complexity works in public space, and some of you might know that in Northern Ireland, which is a quite beautiful natural space, and we think in the same way you can play with public realm to actually allow for BBC concert orchestras, and that's a Beethoven 9th symphony in the central space. And then program the other two to be slightly more background green spaces that have a slightly more quiet identity between the two. And I think for us that's a very interesting kind of different answer to Minories. I think we both find that both this building and Minories are trying as hard as they can within our limits to actually work with the identity that we are given and the local context we are given. And I think the answers are incredibly different, and I think the answers are both valid. And I hope you'd agree that both of them are kind of related to the place, and I'm pretty sure we wouldn't do either of those anywhere else, because they are very much related to the materiality, but also the program and the identity that one finds on each of the sites. Thank you.
Friedrich, thank you very, very much for this lecture. I think we all enjoyed it. Are there any questions? Is there anyone brave enough? Okay, well, I have a few questions because I know I spent a couple of hours with you. I know you haven't been here long enough to actually appreciate the whole of Silesia region, but I wanted to ask you if you found anything, an inspiration, anything unique from whatever we saw without this couple of hours that we spent together. Sorry for the question.
I think there's quite a few things which are unique. The question is, I think, which ones are unique in the sense that they're quite interesting to see, or do they have a potential going forward? And I think there is more sculptural there's more socialist, I think, legacy alive here than I've seen in a happy way, I think, than I've seen elsewhere. And I think that's partly flavored by us doing a couple of projects in Moscow in the moment and elsewhere, where, or for example in Leipzig, where I think the architecture that has been created between the 20s and the 80s is not very respected. And I think the region here is different. I think there is as much as there is in Leipzig and as much as there is in Moscow, but it doesn't feel like it's necessarily beyond its use. And I think it doesn't feel like it's beyond love. And I think it looks like it has a lot more potential and people are much more aware of the potential. I think the other thing that I've mentioned to you a bit before, I think we've worked before in Duisburg. And Duisburg is, I think, to me, the closest I've been to something that's close to here. And I think for me, Duisburg is about 20 years ahead, not in a positive way, maybe, or in a positive way. As I think Germany and the Ruhr region of Germany is as much about coal and heavy industries as let's say, this region of Poland, but in Germany it has already died. And so, on the one hand, there's parts of the Ruhrgebiet which are quite sad, because I think the breaking away of the coal mining and breaking away of the iron and steel production has left behind large voids in very densely populated parts of Germany, with people slightly lost as to what to do. On the other hand, I think Duisburg and Essen and other places are incredibly interesting in terms of what they've done with the legacy that they've inherited. And that was slightly unplanned sometimes, and it sometimes is very planned, like Zeche Zollverein by OMA. And what I find incredibly exciting is to see a region here which is likely to go through the same change in the next 20 years that the Ruhrgebiet has done, but which is at a time where they could actually positively plan for that, rather than what the Germans maybe have done, which is to have dying industries and then start to worry about what to do. I think the other thing that the Germans have lost is a lot of amazing industrial structures, because 20 years ago people didn't realize how amazing they were. And I think that's quite exciting to see that there's more industrial structures still remaining here, which I think if one wakes up early enough as an architect, there's exciting uses to be found, which in 20 years' time people would be extremely sad that they otherwise would have disappeared.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Bardzo dziękuję Wam wszystkim za przybycie. Zapraszam na następny wykład, który prawdopodobnie odbędzie się już w nowym roku.